It's 14 minutes to 7 now, and right here on Morning Express, it's time for us to have a conversation. And today we'd like to talk about mental health. The 10th of October is World Mental Health Day, which is going to be on Monday. And this being the day that we talk about health, we thought, well, why not have a conversation around that to create awareness and also just to demystify. We do know that there are many communities, especially who look at mental health as whether it's a curse, others look at it as witchcraft, and would like to demystify and have that conversation. So joining me this morning, to my extreme left, we have Dr. Catherine Mutisia, who's a psychiatrist. Good morning, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Good morning. And we also have Dr. Dorcas Mwoki, who's a psychiatrist and psychologist. Good morning, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
All right. Dr. Mutisia, let's start first of all with just a very general definition of what mental health is, because many of us, because of our bringing and maybe where we're coming from, when you talk about mental health, we probably relate it to madness. Is mental health madness?
No. First of all, I want to clarify that mental health is not absence of mental illness. And when you talk of good mental health, we talk of a status where someone is able to reach their potential. Somebody is able to adjust to daily stressors, which will happen to all of us. Mm-hmm. And somebody is able to reach their potential. Now, when we move from good mental health, we start getting what we call mental health problems. Mm-hmm. And when it is severe now is when we talk of mental illnesses. Mm-hmm. What people call madness is actually one of the severe mental illnesses called schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. People don't realize that anxieties, substance use disorders, depression, even childhood disorders like ADHD, like conduct disorders, are part of mental illnesses. Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. Dr. Dorcas, how does one tell the different ranges of mental illness? Because I'm sure, just like Dr. Mutisia has mentioned, you have the extremes, which is what we probably relate to and think that's mental illness. Yeah. But you may have mild forms of mental illness.
Yeah. First of all, we take investigations, mm-hmm. and we see whether the patient has got any physical illness. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes with the physical illness, people get also stressed and they can also behave as if they are mentally sick. Sometimes also we have issues like when women are giving birth and they are stressed, they get also psychosis. So most of the times when you get these patients, the doctors have to do investigations to rule out whether this person has got a physical illness. Then after that is when they can diagnose somebody. After excluding, ruling out that somebody is not having any physical illness, which can lead to that stress, which can make somebody to behave as if they are mentally sick, that is now the time you can diagnose somebody to have mental illness.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Mutisia, are there certain symptoms that one can look out for within a family member? Because you don't, sometimes, I don't know if it's like other diseases where the earlier you diagnose it, the earlier you deal with it, the less the effects and the better for the patient and for everybody. If it's one of those, how does one identify maybe mild forms?
Actually, in this year's theme, we are encouraging everybody to be able to give mental health first aid and psychological first aid. That's the theme of this year. And for you to give mental health first aid or psychological first aid, you must be able to recognize the symptoms.
Correct.
And it's very easy. There are three things you'd watch out for. Change of behavior. Normally, if I behave in a certain way or my personality or temperament is known to be this way, and suddenly or slowly my behavior starts changing, you need to note there's something wrong. Or the state of happiness or sadness, mm-hmm. mood. Mm-hmm. If I've been an excited, happy person, outgoing, and all of a sudden I become, or slowly I become withdrawn or sad, that's also something to watch out. Thoughts also. Which thoughts come out through speech. If my speech was optimistic, I enjoyed life, my thoughts all of a sudden or slowly start being negative, sometimes even worthlessness, loss of hope, sometimes suicidal. So basically you look out for those three things, behavior, mood, and actually also thoughts, which you can pick them up from speech.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. And is bipolar, for example, a form of mental illness? Because I know there are many people who probably suffer that and may not think of it as a form of mental illness.
Yeah. Bipolar is a type of a mental illness. Mm-hmm. because the person who has bipolar, they usually have mood swings. Sometimes they are so happy, other times they are so depressed, and even sometimes their thoughts are also affected, as Dr. Tari has said. Mm. Yeah, so bipolar is one of the, it's a mental illness,
it's a
actually.
Mental illness. And maybe just for the benefit of those who may not know what it is, maybe you could briefly give us an idea of what bipolar is.
Yeah, bipolar, as I have said, is a mental illness. Although now it's a slight form of mental illness, because most of the people who have bipolar, you find them, they are stable in their jobs. It's only now the time when their mood is so low and they are depressed. Mm-hmm. Other times you find that they are not able to do anything because of the moods which are low, because of the way some substances in our bodies, we call them those fluids in the bodies, mm-hmm. which make our brains to work the way they are supposed to function. Mm-hmm. You find them, that fluid is usually low, and so they are not able to function well. Also, at the same time, their self-esteem, when they have this problem, most of the times is usually affected. And one is feeling, today I am not able to do anything. Today I'm not in my well moods. Today I don't want to talk to anybody. Today I just want to remain myself. So most of the times you find these people, they are not able to function normally. But if they are seen early and that case is addressed, and they are able to move on well with life,
they can have intervention.
Yeah.
And Dr. Mutisia, once somebody has identified that they may be having a mental illness which they need to be dealt with, where does one go? Because again, like I said, because of where we're coming from and the communities we live in, sometimes there's stigma attached to it. People think you're mad if you say, you know, I have a mental illness problem. Where does one go?
Mm-hmm. There are various places one can seek help, right from the government health centers, the sub-county hospitals, the county hospitals, mm-hmm. the private sector. Mm-hmm. If at that particular health facility you visit, they are not able to deal with the whole condition, they'll refer you. But we are encouraging in this year's theme, World Mental Health Day theme, everybody to be able to give mental health first aid. So that when we talk of mental health first aid, which members of public, just like physical first aid, are supposed to be aware of, we are talking of when you see somebody who is disturbed, that you should approach them and assess them, and we listen. Actually, we have ALG. In short, A is for assess, approach, assess. L is for listen. G is get help for them and continuous support. Mm-hmm. So everybody should be able, instead of running away from somebody who was either disturbed, either they are suicidal or they are violent, or either they are behaving abnormally because they have taken a substance, approach them, listen to them, and link them up with help. Sometimes it might actually be, if it's a suicidal thought, that you take away anything that might be used and link them up for support, or help them until the crisis is over. It could be somebody who has lost a loved one and all of a sudden they can't deal with it. Or in cases of psychological first aid, where there are humanitarian disasters like a bomb blast or like a earthquake or terror activity, such where psychological first aid is needed. You need to assess, look at them, and link them up, orientate them. Some people get so confused, they can't tell what time it is. They don't know, they are not able to even trace or remember their phone numbers of a loved one. So that activity of even assessing them and linking up is very helpful. And members of public need to be able to give that mental health first aid, just the way we give physical first aid.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Now, I'm sure there are various reasons as to why somebody would have mental illness, but maybe you could highlight just a few, especially if somebody was okay and at some point they begin to show signs of going towards mental illness. Maybe they were not born that way. What are some of the predisposing factors?
Yeah, some of the predisposing factors which we have around is stress. Stress can make one to have mental illness. And also at the same time, loss, a big loss of a loved one, a big loss of a job, mm-hmm. a big loss even of a land. Mm-hmm. Those are all the losses. Most of the losses, especially if somebody was not anticipating, they can lead one to mental illness, mm-hmm. after one has got gone through a lot of stress.
Okay.
Another thing is maybe there is divorce, people who are divorced because of that loss, and actually they lived in a good relationship. Sometimes they can suffer from mental illness because of that stress as one is going through the loss. Other times, if somebody has lost a loved one and you are dealing with this issue, because of that, a lot of stress, somebody can also have a mental illness. Another thing is if somebody is sexually abused, one is usually, they usually go through a lot of trauma. And during this time, one can also get mental illness. But first, they get something we call PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Mm-hmm. And that one, if it is not addressed, one can also become mentally sick. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. So once you've identified that those are the areas possibly that are causing you to tend towards mental illness, is there a way of ensuring that you don't go further than, you know, than is necessary? Is there a way of averting? In other words, if it's stress levels that are maybe making me go towards mental illness, how do I ensure that that stress reduces? Because sometimes it's external factors.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, some of the examples you mentioned, if it was a case of rape, it's already happened.
Mm-hmm.
I really have no control over it. How do I ensure that it doesn't take me too far?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what we are saying. By the time you are not stress has piled to the point that it's affecting you,
mm-hmm.
you discover that it's affecting your potential, either your work, it's also affecting your relationships in a way. And also, when you realize you can't address, I mean, you can't adjust to that stress, then it means then you need help.
Mm-hmm.
Help could be counseling, it could be psychotherapy, it could be medication, or it could be more intensive treatment. That's why we are saying when you realize that you're not coping well with, because stresses will always be there. The only difference is, are you able to adjust to any loss? Like I've given an example of losing a loved one. There is the normal mourning, but then in some people it can become excessive or it can get prolonged. Such people will need help. Or even losing finances. Some people are able to adjust and seek help and get support. Also, dependent on how much social support you get to adjust to your stress. So, basically, if you have stress, then you need to be assisted to mobilize your social support to adjust, because if you can't change a certain stress, you have to learn how to live with it or even leave the situation. And if it becomes bad to the point that you need even medication, you should be assisted to get medication and you should be linked up with all social support which is available. Yes.
All right, let's now concentrate on the actual day. How is Kenya going to commemorate that day, World Mental Health Day, which is going to be on Monday?
Okay, as Daktari has said, we have arranged that the celebrations are going to take place in Kenyatta National Hospital, and they will start from the mental health department. That is the place I work, and we'll have a walk. Some staffs, they will be allocated to have a walk. That walk will take place through Mara Road community, come back to Vary Road, come back to KMTC gate, then we come back to the Kenyatta National Hospital, the car park near Doctors Plaza.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll have visitors from the Minister of Health, WHO, and all the hospitals in this nation. They are supposed to come and celebrate with us that day.
Okay,
yeah.
And you've briefly mentioned the theme, but what is it that you'd want to achieve out of this particular day? Mm-hmm. And worldwide, what is the objective of having the World Mental Health Day?
Yeah, the objective of having the World Mental Day is to make sure that people get aware of what is mental health, what are mental health problems, what is mental illness, illnesses, how can we promote mental health. Now, this year's theme is dignity in mental health, psychological and mental health, first aid for all. We are saying that we want first aid for mental health conditions, psychological first aid to be at par with the physical first aid, because every Kenyan knows what is physical first aid.
Correct.
Like if I collapsed here, probably you know what you need to do with me.
Mm.
But if I started screaming here, or if I started beating you, or my behavior changed.
One may not know what to do.
Yeah, or I came to work and I'm not talking to anyone, you might not know what to do. Mm. So the theme of this year is emphasizing that the members of public need to understand what is mental health first aid, what is psychological first aid. And it's very simple. I said simple things like even approaching a person who seems disturbed or whose mood has changed or whose thoughts have changed and listening to them without judging them and then linking up with them for support and making sure that they get support until they get professional help. Remember, even physical first aid, you don't have to make the diagnosis. You don't have to treat. So every member of the public needs to be able to, instead of getting scared, instead of running away, approach the person, listen without judging them, and then try and link them up. But again, you have to, for you to be able to do that, you have to understand basics on what are mental health problems. And that's why we are saying, look out for change of behavior, look out for change of mood, whether somebody is happy or sad, and look out for thoughts which will present in words, in speech. And again, if somebody is not reaching their potential, like you're educated, you're not, you're a professional in a particular line, you're not reaching your potential. Or if somebody is not able to adjust to stress, or somebody is not able to contribute to the community, that is somebody who needs to be assisted. So this year, everybody needs to be able to offer psychological and mental health first aid.
All right, and as we close, and closing comments, is it open to everyone? The walk and the celebration or commemoration, I guess.
Yeah, it is open for Kenyans.
Okay.
Yeah, if you are able to reach Kenyatta National Hospital, you are welcomed.
All right, and it's free of charge.
It is free of charge. Free of charge.
Good to mention that. Thank you very much, Dr. Catherine Mutisia, who's a psychiatrist, and also Dr. Dorcas Mwoki, who is also a psychiatrist and psychologist. Thank you very much for joining us this morning and just bringing us to the fore in terms of World Mental Health Day. Remember, it's going to be on the 10th of October, and that's going to be on Monday, and it's going to be commemorated at the Kenyatta National Hospital with a walk, which you've already given details of. Now, do stay